brought to you by Mint Mobile. With each year that passes, iPadOS is evolving, transforming the way that we work and play. And iPadOS 17 is no exception. It brings us closer to using our iPad to a desktop setup. Now, from multitasking, connecting your iPad to external devices, really the possibilities are expanding and almost limitless. Now, what does that mean for you if you want to be productive on your iPad? Can you truly replace your traditional computer with an iTab? And if you can, what are the limitations that you need to be aware of? Well, in today's video, we're going to dive deep into using your iPad in a desktop setup like I have here with the iPad Pro and the Studio Display. We're going to explore all the new features that enhance your productivity and still what the challenges are in iPadOS 17. So whether you are a professional looking to level up your workflow or a creative seeking to find new ways to express yourself, join me as we uncover all that iPadOS 17 has to offer with its potential. Let's get started. Today's video covers four essential aspects of using your iPad in a desktop setup, and I've pinned each of the sections down below in the first comment. Now, like last year, if you want to use your iPad with an external monitor, you need to make sure that your iPad is an M1 or newer iPad. That's going to include an iPad Air 5 and the 11-inch and the 12.9-inch iPad Pro made in 2021 or after. Now, for my setup, I've chosen the 12.9-inch iPad because I like the additional screen real estate, though I'm probably teetering on downsizing myself to an 11-inch iPad Pro. But either way, rest assured that no matter whether you choose the 11-inch, the 12.9-inch, you're going to get, by and large, the same experience. And really, the only difference is the size of the screen that you have on your iPad when it's plugged in. Now, to use your iPad in external display mode, you'll need to make sure that your iPad is connected to a mouse and a keyboard before plugging in, because if it's not, you'll get a message on your iPad saying it's only available is when you are plugged into a mouse and keyboard. Now, I'm using the Newfie Halo 75 and the MX Master 3. Really, any mouse and keyboard will work for you. It doesn't need to be these two. But when you use a keyboard with the function keys at the top, you do get that benefit while you're in the operating system. Now, I paired my iPad with the Apple 27-inch Studio Display, and it's all connected coming out of the back of the display via Thunderbolt and USB-C. Now, if you look at the back of the Studio Display, I have three different dongles plugged in the back. Now, first, it's the dongle for my light bar. Second, it's the dongle for my mouse. And third, it's the dongle for my keyboard. And this really gives me the flexibility to use any computer, right, that I want to in this setup without needing to kind of repair everything, which I think, in my opinion, is just a pain in the butt. All I do is take the Thunderbolt cable that's plugged into the iPad right now and then plug it into the next device. And then all of a sudden, every device that I'm using is now paired with that mouse and keyboard. It's very easy, makes switching devices very simple. But what if I need more options for connectivity? That's where the CalDigit TS4 dock comes in. And this dock really has a plethora of different connections and gives me the availability to really connect almost anything that I want to, because there's 18 different ports, Ethernet, SD card reader, USB-C power delivery. And it's, again, it's like the creme de la creme of ports, in my opinion, of ports of docks. And I'll leave links to everything I talk about down in the description below in case you want to pick anything up. It'll be there with the timestamps. Now, whether you're looking to simplify your setup or expand your connectivity, these hardware choices, in my opinion, really give a robust foundation for using your iPad as your primary computing device. Now, next up, let's talk about how the iPadOS 17 as a software complements the hardware. But before we do, let's hear from today's video partner, Mint Mobile. Now, if you're anything like me, you are probably tired of your wireless bill burning a hole in your pocket. Well, today I've partnered with Mint Mobile, who might just have the answer to your money-saving prayers. Now, you might know Mint Mobile from their hilarious ads featuring co-owner Ryan Reynolds, but let me tell you about my experience when I switched to Mint Mobile. Imagine having premium wireless service that doesn't break the bank, starting at just $15 a month without needing to compromise on speed, coverage, or data. Now, Mint Mobile operates on the nation's largest 5G network to keep costs very low by selling directly to consumers like you and me without needing to have retail stores or salespeople. Now, just don't take my word for it. Go to trymintmobile.com/caputo to check it out for yourself, or you can click the QR code that is on the screen. Now, all Mint Mobile plans come with unlimited nationwide talk and text, super fast 5G, and free mobile hotspot. And the Modern Family plans allow you to save even more money with as little as two lines. Now, getting started with Mint Mobile is a breeze. With their digital eSIM, you can sign up immediately from the comfort of your own home in as little as 15 minutes. And if your phone doesn't support eSIM, Mint Mobile will ship you out a new SIM card for free. Plus, Mint Mobile has excellent customer service in the event that you ever need to contact them. Now, for a limited time only, you can get their unlimited plan, which is normally $30 a month, for just $15 a month, which is already 50% savings off the already low price. That means that you could be paying as low as $15 a month for your phone plan in as little as 15 minutes. Now, if that is not straightforward, I don't know what is. Go to trymintmobile.com/caputo to get started, or click the link in the video description as the very first link. Again, or you can click that QR code right here on my screen, as it does support the channel. If you already switched to Mint Mobile, let me know down in the comments below. If iPadOS lays the groundwork for what was possible with the iPad, then iPadOS 17 takes everything a step further and refines what's currently there and smooths out the rough edges, so to speak. First, Apple's made significant strides in windowing and window management, both on the iPad and when using it with an external display. Windows are no longer confined to predetermined sizes, and they move fluidly when you resize them. The flexibility of using two apps at once, either in split screen, tiled, or in side-by-side mode, gives you the ability to arrange the windows really however you like them to precisely your liking. Now, for example, imagine you are a student taking notes in class while using Craft to take the notes, and you have the PowerPoint presentation in the background. Well, you can tile the apps one on top of the other with Craft in the front, PowerPoint in the back, and you can tap back and forth between the two apps, bringing the apps forward whenever you need them. Second, adding windows to an existing stage is much more streamlined than it was before. Let's say you want to check email while taking notes. What you need to do is go ahead and hold down the shift key, then click on the new app from either the home screen, the dock, or the app library to add it to the existing stage. Third, and perhaps the most significantly, iPadOS introduces the ability to recognize USB webcams when you're connected to your iPad. Now, this plugged in directly through the iPad or through a hub like the Cal Digit Hub that I have here, this feature allows for easy video calls without the awkward angles of someone looking up your nose from your iPad because it's at that weird angle. What's great is that FaceTime will immediately recognize the external webcam, requiring zero configuration on your port, and it supports gestures for reactions and videos, thumbs up, heart emoji, it supports it all. Doesn't matter whether you're using the first-party camera or a third-party camera. Now, even better yet, not only can you use a webcam, but you can also use a mirrorless or DSLR camera when you plug it into your iPad with USB out for those extra crisp video calls. Now, however, it is worth noting that if you have an external camera plugged into your iPad, if you want to go ahead and maybe change angles, you want to change the first party camera that's in your iPad, you physically have to disconnect your iPad or disconnect the camera from your iPad, which is a big bummer. Now, while not perfect, these enhancements in iPadOS 17 make the iPad a more viable option for people like you and me who want to use their iPads as primary computing devices. Next, let's talk about tips and tricks that's going to make your experience smooth as butter. Now, the globe key is an integral part of the iPad and even the Mac experience. You can easily pop open your emoji picker, maximize and minimize windows, and open the keyboard shortcut picker. But if you're like me and you use a non-Apple keyboard, you're really left in the dust because the globe key just doesn't exist on third-party keyboards. Well, it's good that iPadOS allows you to remap one of the modifier keys to function as the globe key. Now, to do this, you go to Settings, you go to General, go to Keyboard, go to Hardware Keyboard, go to Modifier Keys, and here's where you can remap the Caps Lock, the Control, the Options, the Command Key to the Globe Key. Now, staying on that keyboard theme, iPadOS cannot recognize your fingerprint when you use Apple's first-party Magic Keyboard with Touch ID. This is the actual, you know, the Magic Keyboard that comes with, or you could buy separately for your Mac at $99 and maybe $129 unless you're buying the Space Gray version. Now, that means that you'll always need to use your iPad's biometrics, either Face ID or Touch ID, if you want to unlock the device or use to access your passwords. Now, it's not really that big of a deal, but just make sure that you're not spending the money on a keyboard where you're not going to get the benefit. Now, I do really think that Apple's going to be announcing a new Magic Keyboard for the iPad this fall, but that's for another video. New in iOS and iPadOS 17 this year is the ability to navigate to a website that is embedded in a QR code from a photo. So if you have a screenshot of a QR code that maybe you save for later, like one of the QR codes I talked about here in this video, you can save that screenshot to your photo library, navigate to your photo library, long press on it, and then you'll get prompted to open that up in your browser of choice. Pretty cool. Okay, so even though iPadOS is great and Apple's done a tremendous job of closing the gap from last year to this year, it's not feature complete, nor would I call it all sunshine and rainbows. Now, there are a few considerable gaps depending on what your workflow is. So here's what you need to know from my perspective before you dive into the world of using your iPad as a desktop setup. Now, clamshell mode is made for computers, not for the iPad. The iPad's display can be extended to an external display like we have here, where you can interact with your content in new and exciting ways that really wasn't available before last year. But if you're coming from a laptop environment where you're used to closing the lid and only working on an external display, you're gonna miss this capability because it is non-existent in iPadOS 17 as of this video. Now, what that means is that you always need to have your iPad open, whether it's in a stand like this Infinity Stand from Lab 22 or in the Magic Keyboard, but you will always need to have it open and available because otherwise, if you close the screen, it closes the display, which is kind of a bummer. Second is that if you are using any type of external media, you plug it into your computer, you can read that media, you can write to that media. It even gives you now a visual indication of how that media transfer is progressing. But if you need to format that media, you are SOL, to put it lightly. You would need to take that media out of your iPad and format it in a Mac or PC, depending on what format you're trying to get to. I think you can even format all media types in macOS. Third and finally is that if I'm using the external webcam that's inside the studio display, my iPad will always default to using the external mics that are inside the studio display. I have no way of choosing the microphone And that's because it's auto-configured as soon as I plug it in. Now, that's kind of both a blessing and a curse, because I want the ability to change where I'm going to be able to use the mic or the different webcam without necessarily unplugging my iPad. I talked a little bit about that earlier on, but it's still a bummer that you cannot kind of control which interface uses the mic or which uses the camera. It's always going to be all or nothing. From improved window management to webcam support, iPadOS 17 is really kind of growing up right before our eyes, allowing for a more refined user experience for people like you and me who want to use their iPad as their computer replacement. Now, I want to know what your favorite feature is of iPadOS 17 and this extended display desktop setup. Let me know down in the comments below. My name is Mike, and I'll talk to you in the next one.